Listen up, you are fake news. Hello, everyone. My name is Larry Taylor, and I'm here today with my co-host, Betsy Cunningham. If you would like to ask questions during the show, go to the Uphill Media channel on YouTube and find the show and type in your questions in the chat box. Betsy will relay them to me, and we will do our best to get them answered. Today's show is on one topic, and it's about ICE agents in Astoria. We had an incident recently that we're going to talk about, and it's so fresh off the press. I don't even know what we're going to be doing for our next steps. So just to frame where this is happening. So I live in Clatsop County, which is in the northwest corner of the state. It is the only rural blue county in the state of Oregon. It's light blue. It's not dark blue like Washington County, or deep dark blue like Multnomah County. In terms of the population, Clatsop is right in the middle of all of the counties. So we have about 40,000 citizens, smack dab in the middle. If you go to the major city where most of the action happens in Clatsop County, which is Astoria, we have your classic Main Street. At the west end of the Main Street is our civic functions. So we have the county courthouse, and we have the U.S. post office sitting across from each other. Both are grand old buildings done right after the turn of the last century. The courthouse has a couple of really elegant courtrooms, where justice is served on a local basis. The shot I have here looking down the hallway, we're going to see in some upcoming videos. This is what it looks like when you go into the courthouse. And of course, at the end of the hallway, you have the staircase going up to the second floor, where you have additional courtrooms. We are, as everybody probably knows, the home of where much of The Goonies was filmed. And so behind the courthouse, we have the former jail, which was featured in the movie, and it's now a film museum. So you can go there and see the relics of things like Kindergarten Cops and other movies that were filmed here. Clatsop is viewed as a progressive community, and a lot of people move here because they feel like they can be safe and comfortable here. We always have a huge presence in the Regatta Parade from the gay community, and we've had, I think, our third annual Gay Pride Parade here in Astoria a couple of weeks ago. So we have the illusion of being being progressive, but then we also have this problem with who we elect in the positions of law enforcement, which we're going to talk about a little bit later. So what happened last Thursday was that a guy named Fabian Alberto Zamora Rodriguez appeared in the circuit court for a hearing related to felony charges that he encouraged child sexual abuse. They were aware that the ICE agents were outside the courtroom, and immigrants' rights advocates and the man's mother and partner tightly surrounded him as he tried to leave. And so I have a series of shots from the video. I couldn't figure out how to get the video shown on here, but I took clips of the video of how the whole thing fell down. So the first clip is of an ICE agent who was kind of standing around the courtroom, waiting for the defendant to come out. You'll notice that he's not wearing an ICE jacket. He looks like, anyone running around, walking around Clatsop County. The next shot is a picture of Zamora Rodriguez leaving the courtroom out of a side door. He's with around five people, including his mother, and they were met there by ICE agents and not one but three county police officers. And the next slide, you can see the agent pulling out his pepper spray, which he accidentally sprayed himself with. But this is him shaking the can, pulling out of his pocket and shaking the can, getting ready to spray the people. And so you've got six people that are huddled around, and I guess their tactic is to spray them with pepper spray so they will back off of the defendant so they can then seize him. And that's basically what happened. They sprayed the mother and the other people with pepper spray. They're holding their eyes and trying to, you know, get rid of it. Zamora Rodriguez crosses the hallway, and that's where they appear to have handcuffed him. And then the final slide is of him being walked off in and put into a car. So the Daily Historian published this in the Saturday edition. So I started looking into this yesterday, and I've been thinking about it after the last 24 hours. He was arrested in February after the sheriff's office said he showed up at a local park for what they think he believed was going to be a sexual rendezvous with an 11-year-old boy. And the Daily Historian says that online deputies had been posing as the boy and the boy's 40-year-old babysitter. He's pleaded not guilty to encouraging child sex abuse and other felony charges. And the reason why he was at the courthouse on Thursday was this was a case management hearing. It was a hearing, and there was going to be a case management hearing set for October at that meeting. So he's been arrested. He's not even begun the trial process. So, you know, allegedly in America, we're guilty, we're innocent before we've been tried. And he's being hauled off because he's not a U.S. citizen. So the situation here in Clatsop County is kind of interesting. So Oregon, which has had its sanctuary law for decades, long before the current president was elected, under Oregon sanctuary law, the sheriff's deputies and others in state and local law enforcement are prohibited from enforcing federal immigration law if a suspect's only crime is being in the country illegally. We had a big discussion in Astoria. The mayor at the time, she's like a really nice person, and she expressed her support for the Hispanic community, but said that the city will unlikely not become a sanctuary city. So I don't know what the process is to become a sanctuary city. I think you just pass a resolution saying you are one, and that's the extent of it. The article where this was reported talked about all their concerns about using federal support and getting tangled up with the Trump administration and all that BS. But what was really telling to me was that she makes this pronouncement that the city will likely not become a sanctuary city. She, as mayor, she doesn't get to decide that. There's five people in the city council, and so if three of them pass a resolution saying that we are a sanctuary city, we could have become one. But we didn't have people in the city council who understood that that was their right to do so, or they were not motivated to do that. That's one of the reasons why I'm trying to educate people on their rights when they join these boards. They are not beholden to the chair of the group. They are the deciding body, or the majority is the deciding body, and the chair is really there to facilitate the will of the assembly. So after that, recognizing immigrants' important contributions to Astoria, the city council adopted a resolution reaffirming the city's policy of inclusivity. And in the article in March where they did this, it said that the resolution actually didn't do anything that didn't already exist under the sanctuary law, but it made everyone feel good.
It was like the House condemning the president's racist words. Utterly useless, right?
Less than useless.
Yes, that's what this was, useless.
But, you know, everyone felt appeased, and, you know, the Hispanic Council walked away because they, you know, at least got verbal support from the Astoria City Council. Last year, our sheriff, who's been in office for a long time, became infamous. He wrote a letter that was signed by 15 other county sheriffs supporting the ballot measure that would repeal the Oregon sanctuary law. And if you remember, the voters rejected that measure last November. So here we are in Astoria with the leader of the group who wanted to repeal it. He says, we need to start in supporting ICE in their efforts when people are here illegally. This isn't a game. These people are here illegally, and if ICE has a detainer for them or a warrant, then they need to abide by the laws in the state and the United States of America. I'm sorry, but that's how it is, and that's how it should be. We recently had a change in the district attorney. So for years, we had Josh Marquis, who came to Astoria years ago as a replacement because his former the former DA had to leave, had to resign from office because of her bad behavior. Josh was a huge advocate for women's rights, and I think he would have had a stronger reaction to it than our than who replaced him. So the current attorney, Ron Brown, said, ICE's local action was legal. It's not something we like to see at all, but it does happen. Not exactly a profile in courage. What really disturbed me about the actions that was happening in Portland was that we saw dozens and dozens of ICE agents marching around with billy clubs and guns, and there was nobody showing up from the Portland police who was watching out for the rights of the protesters. And at any point in time, they could have, you know, broken out into beating up the protesters. The next slide is a spokesperson for ICE, and I thought her comments were just especially telling. She said, it is actually often due to the implementation of unreasonable sanctuary city policies that prevent ICE from being notified of the presence of criminal aliens in jails or prisons, which then necessitates that we utilize options like enforcement actions at courthouses to accomplish our law enforcement mission. And by action, she's talking about pepper spray. So she's saying that because, and we're not a sanctuary city, so I don't know why she even said that. But she's using that designation as a reason why they get to pull out the pepper spray. What was especially awkward was finding the comments that were made in closed Facebook groups about this action. If you go to the article in the Daily Historian, they have a comment at the bottom, comment spot at the bottom, and you see very rational human beings talking about, you know, due process and the rights to jury trial and presumption of innocence and all that. But, you know, you get into the closed groups where people feel more free to talk about how they truly feel. The first person said, I know that Hispanic Council is always trying to contact me. My son is half Mexican, so they want to advocate for him. After seeing their head lady protecting this scum, I will not be nice when they contact me again. Another person said, and this is all their bad misspelling, should do more than deport him. That's for darn sure. What a piece of garbage. Next slide. Kind of hard to defend a guy who's trying to sex a 11-year-old. I could give two shits about his race, cut off his nuts, and feed them to him. It's been proven time and again that even with physical or chemical castration, that sexual predators have a very strong tendency to reoffend until a cure is found for his particular illness, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, that's one of our local medical experts weighing in on the issue. Another person said, the Hispanic Council supports child molesters, sick. And then the last one was really interesting. She said, I spoke with a girl a few days back who was approached and asked by ICE to see her green card. She told them that she did not have a green card, let alone speak the Spanish language. She showed them her driver's license, and they left her alone. So apparently they're just walking around, walking up to people who appear to be Hispanic and asking for their green card and I guess deporting them. The more I think about what went on, the more questions I have about what transpired and what is really going on by law enforcement within Clatsop County. Number one, who tipped off? So I guess the ICE agent in Portland or wherever they came from could monitor the hearings in Clatsop County and find out for themselves when this hearing was going on. But why were there three county officers in the courthouse at this particular time? You can see from the video that they weren't doing anything except standing around. But then you start thinking about, well, what is the county doing? You know, in Portland, you know, where you've got 800,000 people, it's a large population, and things have become more anonymous, and you assume that, you know, there's some department that's looking into, you know, sexual predators or online. Here, these are our neighbors. It's our neighbors who are staffing the county sheriff's office and are going online posing as 11-year-olds and trolling for pedophiles. So really, where do they become experts on impersonating 11-year-olds? And are they really getting the training that is needed to ensure that they're not doing entrapment? If you remember, they had the case of the kid who tried to bomb the square in Portland on New Year's Eve, or it was during the Christmas tree lighting or something. You know, they had been nurturing him for a long time, and it became very gray on whether they actually turned him into a terrorist, or if, you know, or if a minor was at such a young age was having such evil thoughts that they needed to throw him in jail for, you know, a decade. I don't know what they were doing to entice him. If he was an immigrant, presumably English is a second language, and so how proficient is his English anyway? What was he responding to when he showed up at the park, and what did he really think he was doing? I don't know if he's like the worst predator we have ever, or if he thought he was helping out a kid who was going to be molested by somebody. I don't know. And I guess we aren't going to find out, because we're not going to see the evidence, because he's being deported or he's gone and his hearing is not going to continue, as far as I can tell. And why? What was he charged with? Encouraging child abuse? That seems really vague. It makes me want to go research how the laws are written and then understand how they're being applied to people. What I don't understand is why the sheriff's agent wasn't asking the ICE agents to follow due process. So nowhere did I see any identification of the ICE agents. They didn't see them show a badge in the video. I just saw them walk up to the group coming out of the courthouse and seizing the guy. I also didn't see any warrant being presented. It was far away, and maybe they did have this like micro copy of the warrant that they handed out and say, look, this is giving us our right to take you away. But I didn't see that happening. Or is there no due process you have to follow if you are an ICE officer? Do you just get to go off and drag people off that you pick up off the street? Like the girl that they walked up to, you know, that fortunately had a driver's license on her. So I'd like to know what the entrapment looked like from Zamora Rodriguez's perspective. What was he really doing? I mean, he doesn't really fit the profile of a sexual predator. I mean, they use the word partner in the article, but they didn't say that he was gay. It's, you know, gays are not pedophiles. Those are like two completely different categories of people. And so the presumption that he was doing this, you know, you can't assume that just because he's gay. Go ahead, Betsy.
Larry, Oz LaFave has a question. What are some of the factors that seem to be enabling this fascist mindset, like the mayor you mentioned, besides Trump? Is it hate, TV, video games? You know, what is your opinion?
Well, clearly the whole 35-40% that support Trump, that are empowered with the white racism that's going on, is becoming more vocal. We see other branches of this showing up in their pushback on House Bill 2020. You know, we're gonna cut down our timber, and nobody's gonna tell us that we can't do that. They're empowered by our president. Usually we go around saying, you know, it's the local elections that are most important because what happens in Washington, D.C. doesn't affect us locally. But here's an instance where clearly executive orders being issued by the president is trickling down and causing actions here in Clatsop County.
Let's not forget that the police overwhelmingly support the president, as do most law enforcement agencies. So they've been emboldened bigly.
Yeah. I'm very interested to see who amongst our elected is going to speak out and demand information from the sheriff. The sheriff believes he's not accountable to anybody. And the only strings he has with the county commission is that they approve his budget. What I would like to see, and I don't know who has the authority to do it, is to have a hearing on what they are doing in terms of entrapment, and are they staying on the right side of the law when they do these kinds of things? I mean, what happens when, you know, you accidentally hit a child porn site because you typed in the wrong URL in your browser and someone's monitoring your website use and you end up with someone knocking on your door, arresting you for viewing child pornography because you did something accidentally, or, you know, you end up getting listed as a child predator by mistake. And you can imagine how difficult that is, getting that erased from your record, because no one wants to talk about it. You've been accused of something that you're not guilty of. It's on your record and it's nearly impossible to remove. And, you know, our Democratic representatives are apparently incapable of talking about ICE in a logical way when there was discussion about eliminating ICE. The Republicans quickly won that argument by accusing them of being un-American and anti-police, when what they were really was talking about was moving the ICE organization into some structure where they had some level of accountability, because they appear to have none at this point. So who's going to speak up and demand information from the sheriff on what's going on? Is our district attorney going to do that? I would certainly like to hear from him, because the quotes that we have from him in the newspaper are pretty much go along, get along. And I hate to invoke Nazi Germany, but that's exactly how the Jewish population was allowed to be marched off, is because they were objectified and they were accused of being diseased and perverts, and basically turned into a class of citizen that it was okay to march off into the camps. And I know everyone gets upset, oh, you know, this is not Nazi Germany, but really, I mean, when I look at that video and I see the unidentified ICE agent go over and pepper spray people who were doing nothing but standing around the defendant. I mean, they got pepper sprayed because they were standing next to him. They weren't doing anything physical. They were just standing there, and that was their way of getting them there to back off so they could seize the guy and go off. And who's going to investigate this? I mean, is our representative Suzanne Bonamici going to get involved in this? I would hope that she would. We're going to contact her office and let her know about this. Will Astoria City Council do anything? Probably not. They would say that this is none of their business. If we go to the county commissioners, I don't know what's going to happen there. I would think that the county commission could hold hearings on what's going on within their body, but we will see. Is there any other comments from the line? We can all speculate about what's empowering this, but we really have to turn things around, because the direction that the country is going in terms of due process and law, is not the direction that I'm comfortable with. Any thoughts, Betsy or John?
I was waiting for Betsy to jump in here on is this the question here. So it's a question or a comment. So are people up in arms about him being an alleged sexual predator, or are they mad he's not a legal citizen and being sent back because no one wants the illegal immigrants to go back?
Well, my guess is that the county is going to line up, if anyone does anything, and that's the first question, they're going to line up into two camps. So if they actually get active, there will be one camp that says, like the comments that we read, that he was an illegal alien and he was illegally in this country. And, you know, the county thinks he's a sexual predator, so we think he's a sexual predator. And because he's an evil person, good for him. Haul him off and take care of him. Then there will be a group of people who understand the implications of what's going on, and they will do something. The progressives have a real difficulty in working together and doing something. So I don't know what is going to come of that. And because this is the federal government, you know, where do you even go? Where do you even start? It's hard to imagine.
That was from Violet Blue, by the way, that comment. Marcus is here, and he says in Germany they had thick leather coats. Yeah. I think we have to start locally. We have to go back there because we know that all the power rests at the bottom. So if we could clean up the sheriff and the mayor, right?
Well, that mayor's gone, and we have a new mayor now. I haven't been watching him, so I don't know what he would do. I would imagine him saying, this is our jurisdiction, hoping the county commission would view this as being under their jurisdiction, because it is a county, the sheriff is a county office, even though he doesn't report to them. It's very difficult to change the sheriff because all of the people who would be viable to run against him probably work for him. And so no one is going to run against a sitting sheriff if there's a chance they're going to lose, because if they lose, he will probably make their life living hell. And especially if you have a sheriff who, with a reputation of being a bully. We had the former sheriff here in Astoria, his nickname was Thumper. And it wasn't because he was a, you know, cute bunny-like guy. He was called Thumper because he had a reputation of going up to people and thumping them on the chest with his bully club. He was a real piece of work. And fortunately, he's gone now. The new city sheriff seems to be an improvement. But I didn't see them at the courthouse. And he would probably say, yeah, it's the county courthouse. I don't have jurisdiction.
Well, it seems to me like there was cooperation, right? So ICE is saying there was no cooperation, and that's why they had to do this way. But there were sheriffs there. It didn't look like, I mean, who told them to be there? I think there was total coordination, right?
And so the challenge is, how do you get the truth? How will someone explain to us what this room is at the county office is, where they do online fishing for predators?
Right.
How are we going to find out the transcript of what they were doing online so we can determine whether this was an entrapment of someone who was otherwise innocent, or if, you know, they really have evidence that this guy is a sexual predator and should be locked up?
But
I don't know how to get to the truth of any of it.
Some of it is through the Oregon public records law. Any of that stuff, now that they're not prosecuting the case, should be subject to disclosure under ORS 192.
Oh, great.
So you can ask for the whole transcript. You can ask for the calls. We have the right, luckily under Oregon law, to have access to information that happens within, you know, the state and local government structure. The federal government's iffy, but all this stuff seemed to have taken place that in the court system, right? The state court system. So you should be able to get that information. But Schultz C100 makes a comment that film any of this stuff if you see it happening, because like in this case, they're doing all this illegally. I think that's an excellent idea that, you know, if I see the police doing something against homeless folks, that, you know, I take out my video and start recording it just to make sure if it ends up being, you know, not what, you know, something it shouldn't be, then I have that information.
Sure. Well, yeah, and weren't you saying that it was a budget that really controlled the sheriff's department? There's a budget in the city council. Isn't the city council the people that are in charge of that? So wouldn't they be able to have some weight over the sheriff's department?
County commissioners, yes, county commissioners, in the county for the sheriff, yeah.
I would think that they would have the power, just like the House of Representatives has, saying, you know, you're not going to spend this money on a wall. And so they could say, you're not going to spend this money supporting ICE. But then they're probably going to say, well, you know, watch the video. We didn't do anything. And so, you know, then you have to track their phone calls. Who actually called up ICE and said that this was going on and that they would be there to support them? What I would have liked to have seen is for the county officers to have stepped in and asked the ICE agents for their paperwork that allowed them to seize this guy in the first place.
Right.
But they just stood there.
Right. And ICE agents often don't have paperwork at all, as we know. The instance of ICE just walking up to people and asking them to prove that they're citizens is not an isolated thing. That's happening all over the country. And the fact that it's happening in Oregon is frightening. So that's no different than Gestapo. That's Nazi Germany 101 right there.
And there's lots of people who actually don't speak English. You know, Texas was actually part of Mexico before we stole it. And there are people in Mexico and in Texas for whom English is not the most comfortable thing for them to be speaking in. They are full U.S. citizens. They were born here, just like all of the white people who think they have white privilege. And if they don't have their driver's license, then I could easily see ICE hauling them off to jail and deporting them to Mexico, to a country where they have no relationship.
Yeah. Great, exciting, uplifting story, Larry. Thanks for
Thank
that.
You.
I'm supposed to do the depressing stuff on Saturdays. You're supposed to talk about the victories in government. Bernie's doing good.
Yeah.
You put the slide in here, so I thought I'd go to it next.
Yeah, I assume that Bernie has taken a position on ICE, and I didn't have time to look it up. I would like to see the candidates address ICE and what they would do with it if they were elected president.
Wow. Kamala supports ICE and their activities. I'm sure Warren wants to give her the money to change. And I'm pretty sure Bernie wants to abolish them. AOC wants to abolish them.
Is that for sure? Any other comments on the line, Betsy? Otherwise, we'll
talk about
some good stuff.
Well, I think that Violet Blue's question may be just more rhetorical, but do we just let our borders open to everyone and as many as we want to come? Yeah. Isn't there a way to bring them in lawfully and safely?
Well, it's really complicated. We have the climate issue, so people are not being able to grow food in South America, and that's one of the things that is driving them up. Our president has cut off a lot of the programs that were in place to help people in their own countries, and that's driving them in. So it's actually a self-fulfilling event that they are being driven to our borders because they are out of food or they're being persecuted in their own countries. They think that the America is a safe haven. And then I'm always struck every time I fly across this country when I look down upon the millions of acres of vacant land, how we could say, as our president did, that we're full up. We are not full up. Some of the most hardworking entrepreneurs that the country has are immigrants because they come here and they see the opportunity and they work hard and they start businesses and they pay taxes and they participate in the system. And if they become citizens, they have to pass a test, which most Americans couldn't pass. And they vote at a higher rate. So, there is a happy balance in there between just throwing it open and letting everyone come here and having some sort of, and having complete control and lockdown borders, which is what we are currently having now. What is going on at the borders is horrific, and I'm just not understanding why more people are not horrified at our treatment of these people. And if Donald Trump is reelected president, I don't think people can run around claiming us as a Christian nation any further.
It's actually very Christian. I mean, Jesus, let's look at Christian history, please.
Well, I'm talking Christian as in Christ would have done, not the metamorphosis that the Catholic Church had done.
Show me where that's being practiced today, please. Show me where that's here. Christianity is a sham. And let's, you know, come on, everybody. We've been walking down this road of Nazism for a while. Most of these people are working in our fields. They ICE captured a bunch of people in Hermiston. They're working in our fields. They've been there for years. And now we're deporting them. So all the farmers that have their MAGA hats on, they're losing their workers. Right. That's,
and they're doing that work because they're doing it at less wages than the U.S. citizens will not do it at. And it's what keeps your head of lettuce, the cost of it low. I mean, if we had people who actually made the minimum wage in this country go out working in fields, picking stuff, the cost of the produce would be 2 to 3 times what it is. But we've been able to artificially keep it low because of these informal systems of hiring illegal immigrants who are willing to work for below normal wages and live in horrible living conditions in order to exist.
Right. Right. Well, that economic distress is coming very soon. Right. Because America's dealing with the Midwest being completely destroyed. So our farming capabilities, our agriculture is getting wiped. Plus, we're losing all the workforce for that. So the Midwest is going to really feel the price of bacon and everything else they love to eat in excess. It's coming. Right? They've already said we're going to have a recession that's going to just wipe out, you know, make the 2008 recession look silly. So,
I have no doubt. People who understand economics call what Trump did a sugar high, you know, the cutting of taxes and giving it back to corporations who didn't reinvest it, but really gave it back to shareholders. That has given us this artificial boost to the economy, which will end. And my biggest fear is that the Democrats will win next November, and then the economy will crash, and then everyone will blame the Democrats, like they always do, for what happened, when it was really a policy of Donald Trump, just like the previous crash was the policy of George Bush.
But then, just like the Democrats always do, they will compromise, capitulate, fall backwards, and agree to whatever ridiculous cuts are pushed through so that we can balance the budget again. But none of that money will go to anything we need. It'll all go to the military-industrial complex, will stay fat and sweet, and nothing will change, except climate change will wipe us all out. Yeah, we got to get out of that cycle.
Maybe you all should go listen to Bernie Sanders' speech.
Yes. Actually, if you heard his, Laura Leibengood dropped this yesterday, but his Medicare for All explanation was really good. He lays down the 5-year plan or 4-year plan of actually what's going to happen, how things will change. Right. So he's on a roll. He's on a roll. Sorry, Larry, I didn't mean to steal you. What do you want to talk about? Oh, this. We should talk about this.
Let's talk about what's happening in Oregon. So,
all right. where?
Oh, why don't you talk about Ken Ward and
all right.
Finish off the depressing stuff.
Just real quick. If you didn't see this on Friday, this was an interview with Ken Ward. It was awesome. He is one of the 5 valve turners. He actually lives in Yamhill now. He's an Oregon resident. And we had a discussion with him. We're going to do a screening with this film. Please go buy this, rent this, watch this. If you are worried about the climate crisis, panicking, freaking out, or disconnected from it, this will help you reconnect, will help you understand, will help you get... It helped me. It was a fantastic film, and I really encourage everybody to watch it. So, excuse me. I sound like you, Larry. Anyway, that's all. Go watch it. We interviewed him on Friday, and it was really good.
And where can people find the interview?
On Uphill Media. Just go to the channel. I have it on the featured on the homepage. YouTube.com/UphillMedia. Now, tell us about PDA America.
So I was talking with the PDA folks last week, and I discovered that the Oregon chapter had not been active. They tried to form it in 2017. It is one of the older groups that has been working on progressive issues. They started back in 2003, I believe. And so we're helping reboot the Oregon chapter of Progressive Democrats of America. They have the same agenda, and they have endorsed Bernie Sanders. And so it seems like a excellent opportunity to move along our objective of reforming the Democratic Party of Oregon. They have contacts across the state, which we will be utilizing. So there are things that you can do if you want to help clean up the country and elect Bernie Sanders. If you've not joined PDA, why don't you go ahead and do that? And in theory, that information will flow to our group, and we'll be able to organize you here in Oregon. We have the Oregon for Bernie group, which you can also join. There's several things you can do there, and we would really appreciate it. We need to know who you are. So if you would like to make the Democratic Party a democratic institution instead of a authoritarian, top-down, compromised establishment group that it currently is, please sign up at OregonForBernie.org and give us your contact information, and we will work with you in your county to help get things straightened up. We would greatly appreciate contributions at the Oregon for Bernie site. We have a couple of slides here that will talk about how to do that. And wear Bernie Sanders apparel, because the way you'll win elections is to be branded and walk around. So instead of wearing your Nike or Adidas branding stuff, why don't you brand yourself for Bernie Sanders for the next couple of months? If you go to the Oregon for Bernie site, you can contribute to one of three GoFundMe campaigns. We have a GoFundMe for printing up Oregon for Bernie bumper stickers. We need just 200 more contributions of $10 each, and we'll be able to get those printed and distributed all across the state. And what we will do is use the existing Bernie support groups for distribution, and we will give them away if we can get the funding completed. We are also installing the Brian Heath signs. Amazingly, over the weekend, they have installed 10 signs in Lane County, which is huge. And we'll talk about those in an upcoming one. But if you have a site for a large format sign, so we paint them on plywood, 4x8 foot sheets of plywood. If you have a site along a highway where we could put one of these, please go to the button on OregonForBernie.org and let us know who you are and where it is, and we will do our best to get one to you. And then if you would like to fund a sign, it only costs $27 in materials to put one of these out. So if you would like to contribute $27 to the creation of one of these signs, please do so. We have about 20 signs out now, and our goal is to get 80 signs placed around Oregon. And then finally, we are funding to get delegates sent to the Democratic Convention. So we're assuming that Bernie will be one of the contenders. If he's not walking into the convention with a majority, it could be a contested convention, and we want to make sure that we send our best activist Bernie supporters to the convention, and we don't want money to be a reason why people don't go. And so just like we did in 2016, we're using GoFundMe to raise funds for that. Unfortunately, the time between the election of the delegates and the convention itself in 2020 is so short that people cannot run their own GoFundMe campaigns and raise the $2,500 needed to attend the convention and pay all of the fees. And so we will use the money we collect to make sure that everyone can go. Go ahead, John.
Sorry, I didn't mean. I just want to jump real quick because we've got a couple donations here, one from Density McCartney and one from Al Walski.
Thank you.
I just want to tell everybody We're always hitting you up for cash, especially the live audience, and you guys are great. It's such a small group of people that really keeps us going. So if you're watching this later on and you're one of the 200 or so people that started watching Progressive Oregon, just know that this is what we do to try to stay alive here and keep our lights on. Nobody gets paid for this. We're not, you know, Larry doesn't make six figures, and it's I'm not really an executive producer getting paid to be one, right? This is, we all do this and spread the wealth. We spend our money, you spend your money. So, you know, help us affect more change, right? Getting the delegates to all of these little things, $2 here, $7, $5, whatever you can, right? Helps out, and the delegates, getting them to the convention is probably the most critical thing in my view, right? Because if we don't have people there to really fight for Bernie at the national convention, it's going to be very easy for the DNC to just bleh, right? So I, you know,
and the only reason we knew about this story today,
Larry, your internet connection, shit, I don't know what happened, you froze. Dang. This happened once earlier. Sorry, everybody. Larry's in Astoria. And we just lost Larry completely. Yay. Well, that was unexpected.
Maybe it's ice.
Could be. My internet service hasn't gotten better over the years. We'll say that. Well, thank you all for being here. And hopefully Larry will show back up. Just remember to go to OregonForBernie.org and do all those things, and UphillMedia.org if you want to help us out. Thank you. We're going to get out of here, of course, with a song we always do. My light's terrible. I didn't shut off the main light. It's really bright. I have Larry's glow. We're going to get out of here with Rage Against the Machine, because it just felt like a Rage Against the Machine kind of morning. This is 6 minutes of Rage Against the Machine. Wake up. And just going to go out with that. It does have bad words. It does have some important information about the FBI and the fact that our government agencies, specifically at the federal level, kind of out of control, and they've been out of control for a while. And the only way to bring them back into control is you and me doing democracy. So let's do that. Like I said, 6 minutes, and there's a lot of instrumental in here. The whole first minute is actually just music. I really didn't know where to start it other than that. So go to the bathroom, get a drink. Come on! Poetic, standing with the fury that they hate.
rape is what she saw.
Hey, John. Hey, Larry.